the model number of this mobile suit, I literally thought people were talking about the fourth version of the MSN Messenger. Well, still, it's not as confusing as mentioning the model number of the AZ Gundam suit anybody. What's going on, guys? MJ2005 Gundam here, and today I'm finally going to be reviewing the real great Sazabi. I've delayed this review for far too long since, well, my dad bought me this guy when Typhoon Mangkhut hit Hong Kong, so, well, I have been putting this guy off for far too long, and yep, this was one of the most, like requested reviews that I would do, because, well, people just really want to see this beast in their own shelves. Well, by this time, people have already seen this beast, so, yeah, there's probably no point in me doing a review, but I'm gonna do one anyways, because I do have my own thoughts about it. Well, straight off the bat, it doesn't really seem that much on camera, unless you know my hand span, which is 20 centimeters, by the way. And, well, this guy is just as tall and as large as the Master Grade GMs. Like, from what I remember in ACGHK, this guy towers just above all 1144 high-grade scale kits. And, of course, it is just on par on with height, poor grammar there, sorry, with the GM, or it is the Jagan, whatever, but yep, it is just as large as a regular Master Grade. Like, I do not even think that the Unicorn Gundam, which is one of the tallest Gundams that I have on my shelf, would even match up to this guy's head height, just because this guy is just so large. It even uses a Master Grade box just to put all the contents in. So, well, this guy is absolutely large, and I have to say, the amount of detail in this guy, although it is just a plain red suit, it has a two-tone red, and it has a lot of gray peeking out of the skirts. It still has potential to improve just because I didn't put on the decals or decals. I do not know which is the correct pronunciation. And of course, well, a bit of painting enhancements here and there. And this guy would just look terrific with all of those mods. I would be sure of that. And of course, this being a real grade, it took me way too long to build this. I took 7 hours in total. Well, probably less than the Unicorn Gundam, but nevertheless, it is still a long and lengthy build. But the results are good looking. So, for the actual stickers, I have used the forehead camera and then the eye. And what's next on the body? I believe there is some silver somewhere, but I believe that is on the accessories. But apart from those, and also a bit of silver lying somewhere in the frame, I really forgot about it because it was just 2 months when I built it, so, yep. But you do have the options of putting on all the decals if you have the time to devote to it. I don't, just because I'm a procrastinator and, well, just relatively busy worrying about life. But anyways, that is going to be the details for the real great Sazabi. This guy is just amazing looking. So for the articulation, I really want to be careful here because I do not want to risk breaking anything. So the head, it can rotate side to side, well, possibly all the way. And it doesn't really have that much motion upwards just because of the entire thing over here. But I really cannot blame it on Bandai, just because the Sazabi's design is to have Char's helmet on the head. So Bandai actually implemented the actual lobe over here, so, well, I really cannot blame them for that. It just hinders a lot of the articulation on the head. And then the arms can rotate, they can come out a bit. The shoulder armor can move independently up here, and then there's a flap over here. These flaps can move for a transformation, sort of transformation to be exact. And then the arms can move outwards, but just because of this piece over here that houses the actual flap, it actually hinders the articulation of the outwards motion of the arm. They can still rotate as usual. It should be like this, but I really like the joint facing forward, so whatever. And then there is a double joint at the elbow, which looks pretty good. And then a ball jointed wrist. But you do get special manipulators, which I would mentioned later on. And then the waist is a bit it's just a bit cumbersome over here, just because, well, it does have a bit of articulation, let me get that clear, but it is because the stomach cannon colliding with the front piece of the front skirts, so it really just, it's hindered unless you cheat and potentially have it just get split in half. So, well, the waste potential is definitely there. And yeah, please glue the headpieces on, just because I had them fall off multiple times when I was trying to open up the cockpit. And then the front skirts are separate, the side skirts are separate, and then the gigantic turtle shell can move. And there is a leg joint over here that allows it to do the wing zero pose, just like all the real greats, except for being covered up by the shadows. And then the legs can go forwards, backwards, outwards all the way, rotation at the hip, a double jointed knee with a very peculiar looking armor separation, if I may say so, just because there's just a gaping gap over here, but nice movability nonetheless. And then there's a double joint in this ankle piece over here, and then there's a flap over here for transformation purposes, and then the feet can go forwards and back, side to side, on the top, rotate, and then the toe can actually move, which is a bit annoying because I really wanted to get a flat foot when I'm posing this guy, but all I get is clown shoes, and yep, this will happen from time to time. And then the backpack, the housing units for the funnels can actually move, and then the fuel tanks can move. So, that is the articulation of the real great Sazabi. I would say it is a big improvement, just because this guy uses a fully custom frame. It is not following on the Shinanju's footsteps by using existing frames. This guy is a custom frame, it has a lot of articulation, and it is very solid. So, before I move on to the accessories, there are a lot of hidden mechanics in this guy. If you do not read the instruction manual, you will miss them. So first of all, you have the opening cockpit, which surprisingly is in the head. I have never watched Char's counterattack, so I really do not know about this. Where the heck is the cockpit? The lens is in the way. And of course, just because this piece is extremely loose, it just kind of cuts loose whenever I open up the cockpit. So yeah, I would advise gluing it in. And then you have some arm extensions, which are triggered by opening up this forearm flap and then tugging the arm down and closing them back in. It's kind of similar to the Unicorn Gundam's transformation, to be honest. And then you have some panels that can move in the shoulders, similar to the Master Grade version KA, or version Ka, as you would like to call it. It can open up a little bit. It's not as extravagant as the Master Grade, but whatever, it's there to be there. So you can kinda do a mini transformation with the shoulders. And then of course these can move up. And then the backpack over here can have this thruster move up, and then these pieces out, and then the turtle shell can expand. And then the side skirts can have these pieces tucked down, if you are careful about it, because if you are not, you would actually tuck the entire piece off, and you would go through the troublesome process of reassembling it again. Bah, I'll just leave it that for now. And let's open up these flaps, why not? The one problem I really have with this guy is just standing. Because, well, ever since the Unicorn Gundam came out, all the real grades have been quite solid. So the Unicorn, the Tall Geese, but this guy, well, although it is pretty solid, let me tell you that, it has trouble standing like all of the old real grades with the complex toe mechanic. Nah, there we go, it's just a crappy pose, but whatever. And then we have the beam sabers that were quote-unquote stored in the forearms. Well, what are they? They are just beam saber heads, per se. These are the real beam sabers that were supposed to come out of the arm, but I kinda get why they did that, because, well, you need to implement some hidden mechanics in there that I will demonstrate later. So you cannot make a mounting port for the beam sabers. But anyways, I can't really blame Bandai for that, they tried their best on this guy, and this guy has a high price, so, well, I should give credit to Bandai, and it does come with two of these clear green, like, effect parts, which looks great. To hold it, you'll have to bring in the holding hands. You have two of these that both have a knuckle joint. And then there's a peg in the hand, so you just put the beam saber in, close it back up. And then they tell you to remove this head for added effect, but I just thought, screw it, leave it on, just because I do not want to lose a single thing on this kit. And to be honest, it doesn't really match the Sazabi, just because it is a large mobile suit wielding such a like medium-sized weapon. So why not bring in something that is relative to its size? The Beam Tomahawk. So this might be an advanced version of the one wielded by the Moon Gundam, simply because, well, the Moon Gundam is the predecessor of the Sazabi, per se. So you get two types of effect parts. You get these shortened axe blades, or you get these poked out ones that really look like tomahawks. And I personally like these better just because they look so cool. I mostly see them on a Shinanju yet again because I didn't watch Char's counterattack yet. And I think the reason I like these the most is because they look kind of look like the energy swords from Halo. I do not know if Sunrise had that kind of inspiration back then. I don't know if Halo even existed back then, but it just looks cool in my opinion and unique to all the beam swords that I'm used to. It is just so cool looking. And if you think the Halo energy sword doesn't have enough oomph, give it another beam. Since there is a flat hole in the middle of the tomahawk. So let's pick it in. It does kind of click into place. So that's why it kind of took me a toll to remove it. But, well, just for some added effect, there you go. Then again, the Sazabi and the Shinanju are famous for using the tomahawks from inside their shields. Here it is. And yeah, it doesn't have the Zeon insignia on the shield just because it is a decal, which I'm too lazy to put on, but well, whatever, the shield is here. The actual shield arm can slide along the track, which is very tight on mine, so I won't want to risk it. For your information, the track is basically these pieces over here, and then it can move up and down here, and that's basically it. And you have a few ballistic missiles down here. So what you need to do to peg the shield onto the arm is just to have this peg into the three holes under the arm, or to the side of the arm if you prefer posing the Sazabi like this. And you can actually peg the tomahawk onto the shield with those missiles on there. So I tried this. It does work, so basically slide it through this gray hole, right down the middle of the connector. Slide the handle there, and at the same time, peg. And crap, I snapped. But if you do not want to be a dumb like me and snap it right on camera, you should remove the missiles first, and then basically shift the positions. But these ballistic missiles have to go in a Ziploc, which is what I do not like about it. And then you have the funnels that are on the backpack. So each of these funnels are individual. It took me quite a while to build. So basically what you need to do is just pull out this tab over here, which I cannot seem to do. And then just open these up. Open the panels up. And they are separate, so they can come out separately. And then you can open the fins up. And now you can have some funnels flying around beside the Sazabi. I don't know if these are your typical 3mm holes, so that you can peg it onto an action base. But, well, it's there. You have so many more posing options. And then finally, the pump action shotgun, which looks very detailed and very nice looking. The red pipes, the red piece that makes up the pipes actually is peeking through the holes in the body of the shotgun. You have a movable gray handle, you have a removable clip, and the pumper actually works. I don't know why you need to pump in a beam shotgun, but It's kind of a cool addition to add to a mobile suit's arsenal, because there aren't really a lot of mobile suits that use shotguns. The only other mobile suit that uses a shotgun that I can recall is the Astaroth Origin. And that is just like a basic handheld secondary shotgun. This is a full-on pump-action shotgun. I hope more mobile suits will continue to have pump-action shotguns in the future, because they are one of my favorite types of shotguns. Anyways, I've been blabbering on for too long. So what you need to do is to grab this trigger finger hand, split it open, and then peg the hole into the peg in the palm. And at the same time, the trigger finger wraps around the trigger very nicely indeed. It looks natural. But then there are extra preparations that you need to do to the arm. So what you need to do is to open this piece up peculiarly and then tug the arm, the fist out. And I do require some mechanical help over here just because my fingers are too fat and big. And is that pulled out yet? I think that's pulled. Oh, for God's sakes. So tug this piece out like so, and then bend it and collapse this piece back down. Don't know why you need to do that, but I think it is to make up space for the back of the shotgun, or basically the stock. And yeah, the trigger finger hand does have the knuckle joint as well. And to add to the funs, Bandai gave you two open hands that actually fit the pose for pumping the shotgun. So, yep, here you go. And let me remove the shield first, because that's getting in my way. Well, that's the best I can do on the spot. So that is a cool addition to the real great Sazabi. We don't see much of that in the entire Gundam universe. Unless there are some mobile suits that I'm not aware of, so yeah, correct me on that. And then finally, I cannot forget Char Aznable, because people would get pissed off me if I forgot about the actual action figure that is in the kit. So that's all the accessories for the real great Sazabi. Now for comparisons, let's bring in its predecessor, the Moon Gundam. So from the predecessor to the successor, the Moon Gundam surprisingly kind of stands up to the Sazabi. Now I kind of feel like the Sazabi scale does make sense after all, because I have never seen like the Hydro Gundam, which should be larger than the real great Sazabi. I cannot picture the Hydro Gundam being taller than the Sazabi because of its massive size. But now that the Moon Gundam and the Sazabi are side by side, it's starting to make sense. So that is going to be the review for the real great Sazabi for me. What do I think of this kit? Well, I think this guy does hold up pretty well. It is structurally tough. But then there are certain pieces of armor that will fall off way too easily, thanks to me just activating the mechanics and stuff. And of course, the head fin over here that goes on the back of the head constantly falls off when I want to just open up the cockpit hatch. And also, this guy cannot really stand, especially on this kind of uneven terrain, due to the complex toe mechanic that Bandai has. Due to the complex toe mechanic that Bandai has implemented in real great kits in the past, so this guy really cannot stand in the way that I like to, just flat feet on the ground. But all in all, the good points of this kit outweigh the bad points of this kit, just because pump action shotgun, Char Aznable, and just a large real grade in general. And of course, how could I forget the awesome shield that I broke? But anyways, if you do not have this guy, go pick it up if you can afford to buy this kit, and of course the space for it, just because this guy is as large as a master grade. And that's all I had to say. This guy is just a generally good kit. And although it is a step back, or should I call it a semi-step back in the real great line, It is definitely a real it is definitely living up to the structural integrity standards that the Unicorn Gundam has set. So that's all for me. Thank you all so much for watching this video. If you did like it, please be sure to drop a like, comment, and also subscribe for more Gunpla reviews, Gunpla news, and all that kind of stuff. And I will be disappearing until December Subscribe to the featured channels on my channel page if you haven't, and I'll see you all in the next video. Peace out, guys. Bye-bye.